Thank you, Manuel. I think we have 10 minutes for a little conversation between us before we open to the floor. Thinking about a 21st century museum and thinking of Louvre and the historical Louvre in Paris, which is housed in Palace, and then how you moved to Louvre Lens and the learning that took place to take an encyclopedic collection historically deep to a very contemporary museum building, and how that particular museum then informed Louvre Abu Dhabi. Can you tell us a little bit about that? Those shifts and the learning.
No, very good point that you mentioned Louvre Lens, and quite amusing that now we need to say Louvre in Paris, or we don't say Louvre Paris. They hate it, and so it's the Louvre, which is in Paris. But indeed, you're right, absolutely right. I didn't mention to make it too complex, but indeed, the Lens, which is a region in the north of north of France, has had a specific partnership with Louvre and created this incredible, it's a very beautiful building designed by Sana, and it was indeed one of the first ways of playing with universalism in the 21st century. And I think that the British Museum is also doing experimentation, the Ashmolean Museum is doing experimentation. So there is something happening in the world of museum around revisiting the universal approach. In Lens, they've done it in a way. There is this place called La Galerie du Temps, the Time Gallery, in which you have the same co-visibility of artworks, with a very clear reading on where you are in time, because you have a chronological line on the wall, and you can see objects of the same civilization are still in archipelagos, not together. We are going further to that, and it is limited, quote unquote, limited to the Louvre collection. So they don't have Asia, for instance. So I think we were in this dynamic of reinventing the Universal Museum, and we just brought it a few steps further.
So having that moment to be able to reflect on breaking down sort of particular siloed departments, say, in the museum, and being able to show the cross disciplines and cross historical lines in the Lens took you to a whole other world, if you like, in Abu Dhabi, because of the access to a much greater suite of collections. Yeah. Absolutely.
But I think the two great Louvre president have overseen you, the very tall guy on the picture signing Henri Loiret, and the current president of the Louvre, Jean-Luc Martinez, both of them have, let's say, by their aura in the museum world and in the French museum world, especially the capacity also to sum up this universal discourse. So what you need is to be able to, to take the objects from all of the museum and to be able to summon them. And the Louvre has this capacity. The voice of the Louvre speaks beyond the Louvre itself, or the limitation of the collection of the Louvre. So I think the vision of these two persons and the continuity over 10 years is also one of the reasons why it worked.
Can you talk a little bit about the more recent historical galleries, as we get closer to our time? Mm-hmm. Maybe it's interesting to also share difficulties of dealing with, say, the 20th century as distinct from the 15th century or before.
True. And this is a challenge we have in Louvre Abu Dhabi on the end of the parcours, because the anthropological tools that we were using at the beginning to show the commonalities are quite clear, really because of anthropology, because of knowledge, because of a common point. And when we arrive to modernity, all the lines are blurred. And so what do you want to show? The pure essence or the influence? Do you want to classify by... there is a temptation to go back to the regional approach, to have one Indian artist, one Chinese. And so there is, we try to show commonalities, and we try not to go back to the geography or to the separation. But this is a space we are questioning all the time. And maybe the answer is in constant or even more rapid changes of these rooms to be able to play and to adapt with creativity.
It's also interesting because the earliest archaeology is these are religious objects or vessels. They had different functional histories, and when you come closer to our time, we have formal art that has a very different place in society, in culture, as distinct from then, say, design, and how those our much more complex structures of what we define as visual culture starts to be expressed. And I think some of those difficulties in the more contemporary galleries are because of those big shifts.
We try to tackle that by having also some decorative art. Huh? So we have this room, this period room, the Ruhlmann decor. We have then the question is the number of artworks on the. I said earlier the temptation of exhaustivity, which is in every museum, and when we try to tell a story, so there is a rhythm in the story. Mm-hmm. So keeping this rhythm when we arrive to what is very close to us, and modernity and contemporary time, it's indeed very difficult. So, but I totally agree with you. The decorative art have to be there, and I think they have a place in Louvre Abu Dhabi. And similarly, I know that in M+, you're thinking of showing the image, the moving image. It's also, I should have insisted, in terms of rupture or continuity in the period, we don't say this is the Industrial Revolution when we arrive in the 19th century, but the rupture we chose is photography. And so we start this room by photography, and we finish it by the invention of cinema. Which is, and so this is a way also to pay tribute of other ways. But how do you, you need more space.
More space. Talking about more space, what was also very beautiful about the hang of the institution is the generosity objects are given. There is a generosity of space around objects that are gives pause. And I think that is, I'm sure, very deliberate, because you probably had to make very critical choices to say no to a whole range of things.
It's horrible for the team to have to choose. Luckily enough, they can choose from some of the best collection. And thank you to say it, because it's really something we wanted to do, and which is a success. We have, I didn't show it, but we have from Fontainebleau Castle, the Apollo by Primatis. They have a series of these 2 meters high bronze, fantastic, very strong cast by Primatis. But in Fontainebleau, they are all together in a hallway, a little dark. It's beautiful because you understand how it was when it was a castle. So in its place, it makes sense. But taking one of them, which was an incredible loan, and putting in the center with natural light, was something incredible. And the Fontainebleau team, when they installed it, and they say, okay, we admit, in this occasion, this artwork traveling, maybe we see it a little bit better or a little differently.
Just one last question before I throw to the public. The audience and the fact that your average age is 38, that's a very young audience already, to say that the average age is 38. And what do you make of that? What do you think about that?
I think this 38 is heavily driven by the demographic in the UAE. So it means indeed that we need to As I was saying, we need to invent. We have an opportunity and also an obligation to invent new ways of touching these publics. There is a museum tradition and a cultural tradition in the UAE, but you don't have this universal museum. So, a little more effort on our side to bridge the gap, to go to the public, to find ways of interesting them. Talking to them, to Emirati, but also to all the nationalities who are there. They are young, so social media are very important, interactivity, we need to be high-tech savvy, and at the same time, we are promoting very old artifacts, and I'm very proud of that. We are a museum of real objects, so and this is something I'm adamant. We are not a museum of reproduction, we are not a museum of virtual image, we are a museum of real artifact, and this is what we offer to the public, the authenticity of that. So you can use the digital techniques to interest, to enrich, but driving people to the real thing.